Good afternoon, everyone. This is Brother Lloyd, and to those who are keeping the Sabbath today, Shabbat Shalom. I hope you are all having a blessed, peaceful Sabbath day. Now, last week's study, I had some recording issues with, so I'm going to have to go back and redo that one, and I'll eventually get that one posted, hopefully later on today. But I'm going to do today's study right now, which is titled, Don't Make Excuses or Accept Excuses for Falling to Temptation. And we're going to be coming out of John 8. Now, people, understand that other people are great at being judgmental of you when it comes to defending their own actions. And some of you have been that person. See, the trick is to call you out and make you appear as guilty about doing wrong as they are. And some of you have been that person. So it works both ways. If someone hasn't done this to you, then you've been that person. So you can relate from either side. But the point is, if this can be accomplished, then you can justify, or they can justify, their actions through their own wrongdoings, be it past or present wrongdoings. And generally, it starts out with something that's going on now, and as the contentiousness goes, then past stuff starts getting brought up, etc., etc. So, keep in mind, we are all guilty of what we're guilty of, but we have to remember that we have an advocate and a way to clear our own issues, and it's definitely not through another individual man. So we definitely don't have to accept others' wrongdoings because of ours. But we have to make sure that we're doing right and that our lives are in check and that our transgressions of the past have been repented of and done away with, we've turned away from, and we're living according to the Father's word. Because if not, as soon as you go to call someone out on something they're doing wrong, it's coming right back at you. So you want to have that solid foundation to stand on if you're going to point out wrongdoing. We can point out wrongdoing, hate the sin but love the sinner. But that doesn't mean that we can't point out sin, but do it in love. Do it in love. Now, to John 8, and we're going to start with verse 1. And it reads, Jesus went unto the Mount of Olives, and early in the morning he came again into the temple, and all the people came unto him, and he sat down and taught them. And the scribes and the Pharisees brought unto him a woman taken in adultery. And when they had set her in the midst, they said unto him, Master, this woman was taken in adultery, in the very act. Now Moses in the law commanded us that such should be stoned, but what sayest thou? At it again, Sadducees and Pharisees, and we have people playing that role today. This, they said, tempting him, that they might have to accuse him. But Jesus stooped down, and with his finger wrote on the ground as though he heard them not. Now, we're going to start right there, and we're going to go over to James 1, and we're going to start with verse 13. Verse 13 reads, it says, Let no man say when he is tempted, I am tempted of God. For God cannot be tempted with evil, neither tempteth he any man. Now, the word or the Father is clear about this. Listen, it says, God, or simply put for us laymen, anyone who has a father in them or claim for that matter to have the father in them, cannot be tempted with evil or sin. This means that if you are living your life according to the will of the Heavenly Father and what He has laid down for us, you will not be tempted. You will do right. Verse 14 reads, But every man is tempted when he is drawn away of his own lust and enticed. Then, when lust has conceived, it bringeth forth sin, and sin, when it is finished, bringeth forth death. So, when we want something or want to do our own thing, the temptation before us will take root because of what? Because of our own selfish desires. Not because anyone makes you. It's because you want to. Then you proceed to do the wrong sinful thing and suffer death. Now, if it doesn't literally kill you, because some people do things that literally cause them to die. They do sinful things that literally cause them to die at that moment. But if it doesn't kill you then, we're talking what? We're talking about a spiritual death, people. We're talking a separation from the Father. So always keep this in mind and understand what it's saying. See, people take stuff as having to be literal, and it doesn't prevent them from doing. A spiritual death is just as literal as an actual death. Keep that in mind. Now, let's continue on with James 8 and verse 7. And it reads, "So, when they continued asking him, he lifted up himself and said unto them, He that is without sin among you, let him cast the first stone. And again he stooped down and wrote on the ground." Now, here again, in verse 7, we see, for the second time, our Savior stooped down and wrote on the ground. First time in verse 6, he says that he did it as if he didn't hear him. So basically, he kind of ignored them. He stoops down and he's writing in the dust of the ground. So obviously, we know he's not doodling or scribbling, drawing shapes. He's writing something. And he's writing something that is very profound and important. Now, there are several views of speculation on what he was writing, because no one's for sure. But see, I subscribe to this belief in what he was probably writing. Now, as the accusatory crowd was around him and wanting to stone this woman for her alleged sin, when he knelt down, he was writing on the ground for all those who were gathered around him, and he was writing something to grab their attention. As for when he got back up, he said, "He that is without sin among you, let him cast the first stone." And then he stooped down and continued writing. So what is probable that he is writing? I believe he was down there writing the sins of those all gathered around. And he was writing those sins. And remember, the Father knows all. He knows everybody. He knows everything about us. So as he knows who's around him, he's writing their sins one by one. And those individuals are what? Verse 9 reads on, "And they which heard it, being convicted by their own conscience, went out one by one, beginning at the eldest, even unto the last. And Jesus was left alone, and the woman standing in the midst." Now, they heard him say that. So obviously, when he said, "He that is without sin among you, cast the first stone." So between that and the writing, and each individual seeing his own sin, they were being convicted and called out by their own sin. And that's a very humbling thing. See, when people call you out, they can zip you up and have you kind of filter away. And I believe in the words that he was writing, that's what he was doing, writing down their sins. Now, I'm not going to debate that one way or the other, but irregardless, he was writing something profound enough to move people. See, because people can call you out all day long, but if there's no evidence of what they're saying, you'll stand and debate with them or whatever, shrug them off and keep on going. But if they present evidence, writing it on the ground, that's doubly humbling right there, because you're wondering, man, how do they know this? Let me go and get out of here, because I don't want to be thrown up under the bus in front of everyone. So as to that, they started scattering. They were like, I'm out of here. And people started leaving. So everyone walked away with their own little skeletons and carried them back to their own closets, because they didn't want to be called out, whatever it was. Now, verse 10 and 11 read like this, James 8, verse 10 and 11. "When Jesus had lifted up himself and saw none but the woman, he said unto her, Woman, where are those thine accusers? Have no man condemned thee? She said, No man, Lord. And Jesus said unto her, Neither do I condemn thee. Go and sin no more." And understand that this woman, as guilty as she may have been, was given opportunity, as we all are. By who? By the Savior, by our Heavenly Father. See, more illustration, always illustrating to us what we must do and what we can do to be absolved of the lives we lead that are in sin. He told her that he doesn't condemn her and to go and sin no more. So what he did was he gave her a commandment, and in that purifying power of his word, he cleansed her of her sins, and then said, go and sin no more. Because what? Because she was a new creature. See, he created a new life in her because of her belief and absolved her of that sin. So go with me to Isaiah 1:18, and it reads like this. Verse 18, it says, "Come now and let us reason together, saith the Lord. Though your sins be as scarlet, they shall be white as snow. Though they be red like crimson, they shall be as wool." And then that leads us to verse 26 in chapter 43:26, and it reads, it says, "Put me in your remembrance. Let us plead together, declare thou that thou mayest be justified." So these two scriptures were run together, one referenced the other, to explain itself. So to be justified means what? It means to be declared innocent or guiltless, absolved, acquit, or simply put, it means to be made just or right. And according to verse 43:26, when applied together, all it's saying is that we're to do this by thinking through logically with Him in our remembrance, by making and we do this by making an appeal or plea through Him as a way of being declared innocent or made right. So we have to do it through Him, and the only way we can do it is by having Him in our remembrance. And we do this by what? We have to study the Word, people. We have to put it in. We have to put it in there so we know how to go through it, go to it, and so that we can get to it. So my lesson to be learned from this study is what? People do whatever because they want to, usually because they don't want to let something go of the world. For instance, fame, the past, money, a good job, their current standing in society, or what have you. People don't want to let things go. They will hang on to the sin that these things have brought into their lives and not move past it because they can't and won't let go. Not being able to let go of something is what? That's an addiction within itself. People are addicted to things. People are addicted to characteristics, behaviors. People are addicted to all these things, not just drugs. They are an addiction created by the enemy through temptation. And in this very selfish character created in people, it can cause them to justify everything that they do and even blame others if necessary to defend themselves. So the behavior in this person or any person can do what? It can drag down relationships, it can drag down families, and it can even drag down in the individual itself, with which it always does. It always drags down the individual, but there's always collateral damage, and usually family and other people who are close to them fall with them if they don't have the strength to overcome it. And then sometimes they go through so much before they overcome it, it brings them down to a low point in their lives anyway. So keep in mind that this is a deception by the enemy, who caters to the selfish desires by what? Tempting us, because all the enemy can do is tempt us. He cannot make us do anything. Go with me to James 1:14, which is said, it says that what? "But every man is tempted when he is drawn away of his own lust and enticed." There's nothing in scripture that says the devil can make you do anything. The Father doesn't make us do anything. What makes you think the devil has the power to make you do anything? The Father gives us free will, and the devil waits for opportunity to screw up your life if you invite him to do so. So the Sadducees and Pharisees, in some regard, sometimes are akin to what? People and those in our lives with a closet full of skeletons. But they're always quickly willing to call you out, point fingers at you, or blame you for the problems in your relationship with them or even the household. And worse yet, they are willing to destroy that family or household because they haven't or won't acknowledge their own sins, they won't repent of those sins, and they won't come to live according to the word of the Father, which they claim to know and love, because there are plenty of people out there claiming to know God and love God, and they talk God and this and the other, but they are living with so much sin and skeletons in their closet that it makes no sense. But to the victims, I say this: press forward with the Father by your side and use Him for your strength and support, and allow Him to carry you through your tears and your pain through what? The powerful, comforting words that He has and His love. And you have to pray and stay the course for that lost soul in your life. And that may mean sometimes you have to let them out of your life, but do all things according to the Father's word and do it in love. And with that, this is Brother Lloyd. I'm out.